Okay. Thank you very, very much for inviting me to come here. I'm sorry that the original protagonists of all this story are not here. I also want to say that I wasn't really a great physicist when all this occurred. I'm not either now, but I have survived for enough years, 50 years. So I decided to make a talk more about John Wheatley than and where the dilution refrigerator came into being, rather than praise the glory of something that I have done. So it's these are more memoirs than facts in some ways, because that was a time in which students and postdocs didn't travel to conferences. Only the big shots, they had to spend a lot of money on an airplane ticket. So I never went to a conference until the Quantum Fluids Conference in 1967, where I interviewed for a job. That was my first trip to any meeting at all, and I already had been a postdoc for 2 years, so that was the policy in our group, in the group of John Wheatley. Anyway, so I'm going to tell the story as I know it, and where are the arrows here? Let's see if I go one. How do you progress on this?
Well, you can use this.
Oh, this one.
I will just press.
The right button. Okay, thank you. Yeah, there. Okay, so first of all, this is a brief biography of John, what his life was. He lived only to be 49 years old, so died of a heart attack while riding his bicycle in Los Angeles. And of all the things that happened in his life, two things really had a tremendous influence on him. The first one was his visit to Leiden on leave. Yeah, here in 1954-55, and was at Oxford in 1955 for a little bit with the Fulbright and Guggenheim fellowships. And he was extremely impressed by the high quality of the work being done in Leiden. And eventually, on the 400th anniversary of the university in Leiden, he was given an honorary degree. He was a very good friend of you, of Rudolf. The other was that, he had this general spirit to do good. And so he went to Argentina in 1961. For a short leave of 6 months, ended up staying 18 months there, working with us, and that's where I met him. And eventually, I went to work with the lab in Illinois. So move along. We was in Los Alamos, in which Jeff returned to UCLA when he died suddenly. Here is a picture of what the Illinois lab was like. I just wrote on the top here. And Leiden in 1954, John decided that he was not going to work anymore on nuclear orientation, and that he was going to start working on helium-3 and liquid helium-3. He was fascinated by properties, and so when he returned, all the lab was dedicated to working on helium-3, and some of the most, he built a fantastic cryostat for the time. It would work down to 3 milli K. And did all of these things that you can find in books now about zero sound and everything. And I always like to show the picture of the zero sound measurements, because it was a beautiful demonstration that this thing existed and it could be done. This is in 1957, so before his trip to Argentina, Wheatley had a lab there, and it, the lab was very small. They shared a room about the size of this front, from here to the back, with two other faculty members. And so the cryostat was a little cryostat that was on the back. Eventually, he had appropriated some space behind and built a giant screen room where all, a lot of the experiments were done. I got these pictures from the archives of the University of Illinois. When he went to Argentina in 61, 62, this is a picture from last year from the ULT conference. This was the view from my hotel room, actually, in Bariloche. Beautiful place. That's where I studied, did my undergraduate work. A low temperature lab had been started there in 1959, the idea came, and the actual physical lab started in 1960. And it was designed by Jim Daniels, who was a student at Nicholas Curti at Oxford. And Jim is the guy that discovered the CMN, and it's the CMN thermometer with Daniels and Robinson paper that we use for a very long time, especially at the time of adiabatic demagnetization. So Wheatley was the third foreigner to come over to help us build a low temperature lab designed after the Clarendon laboratory. He had a hydrogen liquefier, a Linde hydrogen liquefier, and a Linde helium liquefiers that use hydrogen, and we never blew up, although it had been predicted that we'd all die in a gigantic explosion, ball of fire one day in there. We transfer hydrogen all the time. So this was the back of the lab, and the hydrogen liquefier was in a shack on the back that could blow on its own without killing anybody working inside the building. And this is a picture. Wheatley came back in 1964 for a visit, so he was there. This is me, actually, when I used to look young. Anna Celia Mota, who some of you know, she worked on superconductivity at ETH in Zurich. This is Francisco de la Cruz, who is a member of the National Academy in Argentina and organizer of the last low temperature conference. This was my thesis advisor, official thesis advisor in Argentina. And all these things that Wheatley did couldn't have happened if it wasn't for Andy Anderson running the Illinois lab at the same time. They had a radio transmitter installed in Argentina and one in Illinois, and they would communicate almost every other day by radio, by amateur radio. And Andy ran the lab in Illinois. I met Andy eventually when I moved to Illinois. Unfortunately, Andy passed away in March of this year. I was hired actually as an employee in Wheatley's lab in December of 1964. I haven't done my thesis yet, in Argentina you only needed to do a thesis, so I went as a worker and did my thesis, and then I eventually went back to Argentina, submitted it, and came back to Illinois with a postdoc. The lab was really an enormous, it was really a fantastic place to be. David Edwards, who was at the time at Ohio State, he was also from England here too, he had just shown, when I arrived, he had shown that there was a finite solubility of helium-3. At very low densities, and the curve didn't go to zero like it was thought at the beginning, Wheatley with Edwards can measure the 5% and 2% solutions of helium-3, helium-4, the heat capacity all the way down to about 3 millikelvin, and they had shown that it just looked like a gas, so there was no more phase separation. But it also had, they had in Illinois a tremendous group of theories. John Bardeen, David Pines, Leo Cadenao, Gordon Bain, all of them were faculty members there. And they used to drift by the lab all the time. Every Saturday, John Bardeen would come to the lab, and John Wheatley would sit in front of him over a table, and all of us peons would be sitting around this table, seeing these two people talking about what had happened, and John Bardeen said, I think I understand this. And go back, and the next week we come back, I think the solutions look this way. And it was really quite a fascinating time. This is a picture from the newspaper, or the student newspaper in Urbana, and here's John. This is the apparatus that I built, actually, in 1965 to do my thesis with adiabatic demagnetization, and this is the old magnet there. The real work was being done in the screen room in the back, but there was no room for a photographer to get in, so John just sat in front of my cryostat and got a picture there. So there were lots of other experiments going on in parallel in the screen room in here. And you can see that John had 9 students, and I was a postdoc. Had a lot of work to do there. Then came this conference here where John Hurst, this is why I asked the question, which year was it? I didn't travel. All I remember is that I had finished my thesis and John came one day to the lab and said, you had to drop everything. We had to build the dilution refrigerator. And I didn't have any idea what it was. So it wasn't my idea at all. He knew what it was. I was more an expert in adiabatic demagnetization and paramagnetic salts, and we can measure the heat capacity following Leiden in England, in Oxford and Berkeley measurements of heat capacity of cerium magnesium nitrate and other things in it. But John always traveled with a whole bunch of his notes. And he was so meticulous that he had, he kept tables with the properties of everything that had been measured. And out of these tables on the fly back from England, he calculated a discrete heat exchanger, what it would look like if it was done with sintered copper instead of being the continuous heat exchanger that was used here. And then so he worked on that. And when, like I put here, he told me that here are some notes from when I left John Crook for my own life. He gave me Xerox copies of many of his notes so I could keep working on the dilution refrigerator. So he had all of these. So these are now from 1967, these ones here, when I left. He flew from here actually to Helsinki and chatted with Olli Lunasma, and then got the Jutta Einholm, came over from Lunasma lab and worked with us. He helped build the heat exchangers, the first heat exchangers. I did all the rest of the plumbing, and while keeping another student working on an adiabatic demagnetization project. And then we tried, I remember trying it in a night, and the first version reached 40 milli-K on the first try. It had 4 small heat exchangers it looked like a Kitchell flight or a pan with a mixing chamber in the middle, actually, to try to prevent the instability, gravitational instability. Happened something, and this is what was John was all. John was always this way. We tried to modify something, change one heat exchanger, etc., and then they never work. This fridge anymore. And John always, when something didn't work, he said the best thing is to start over. So everything was thrown away basically, and started with the steel. How does the steel work? And we had a good helium-3, helium-4 leak detector that could measure the proportion, the temperature, the exact temperature to circulate it. And all of these were put on tables, how it would work. Then we added one heat exchanger, copper heat exchanger, and measured the heat transfer, the Kapitza resistance, what temperature would work and how it worked. And when we were all sure that it was working, then he built one with a chain of heat exchangers. And the first night it ran, was supposed to run, and it ran. And it got to 20 millikelvin continuously. And then a few nights later, we were just doing measurements. John would stay until about 2 or 3 a.m. in the lab, and then he'd leave. And then I stay the rest of the time. And while I was shutting down, I noticed that the temperature was going down, probably with half eyes like this, just looking at, And that was when John came the next day. I said, John, if you close the input, the temperature goes down, right? And he said, yeah, of course, because there's no heating. Immediately he figured out what was going on. We wrote a paper. He and I wrote the draft and everything, and then we sent it right away to Physical Review Letters. We thought it was really good. This is the old design. We had an Edwards 2M4 pump. It was a mercury pump. They had a back pressure with 50 torr. And 50 torr, if you had a helium-4 pot that went down to 1.1 Kelvin, then you could condense the helium-3. on the way back. So it was really no mechanical pump. It was just a mercury pump running here and putting it back in. It had 4 heat exchangers, and this was the design. So this is what we did. And in spite of great fight with the editors of Physical Review Letters, the answer was that the paper was not accepted. Since the paper was not accepted, we kept going with this. Here is some photographs. This is not John's, this is mine. When I moved to, I got my jobs thanks to what I had done here at the University of Washington. John's notes and a few changes, ended up building my own dilution refrigerator. And this is what it looked like, identical to the first one that we built in, that's one that we built in Urbana, except I added one more heat exchanger. And I got rid of the mercury pump. I put a regular pump. And this looked very much like Peter's cryostats with the glass doors. I broke glass doors, too. I survived breaking glass doors. Had a nice helium 4 pot, and this is a shield. We removed the shield, and you see the fridge inside. And this is a mixing chamber, and attached to it were the cells with which the first measurements that were ever done on helium-3 films below 1 Kelvin basically were done on this cryot. And the first use of squid magnetometer was done on this cryot too, to measure the temperatures of the samples. Okay, then in parallel with that, then we decided to go ahead and add, because we could close the input, if we had another dilution refrigerator that had only, that didn't circulate, it should go to lower temperature. So this is the one cycle fridge attached to the 4 heat exchanger version of the dilution fridge. So here is the one cycle mixing chamber on this side with a CMN thermometer to measure the temperature. This is made out of epoxy, and all the tails of these cryostats were all made out of epoxy, so we could use a mutual inductance bridge to measure the temperature. So this one went to 4.5 milli K. So we wrote another article for Physical Review Letter. I forgot about the first one, and wrote it down about how we could get 4.5 milli Kelvin with in a single cycle. And this paper was also rejected because having nothing of scientific interest on it.
When was
it? This was in 1966, 67, you know? Here's the eventual. So at that time, physics letters, it was sort of just more or less started. And they were accepting papers that were a little bit less. They were considered lower quality than Physical Review Letters at the time. But they had to be short. They had to be 2 pages, maximum 2.5 pages. And so we removed the cryostat details and wrote this paper. They got published. And that was our claim to glory. So the date of the paper is 67. It probably was written at the end of 66, beginning of 67. Like I was telling Ian Nieki, these are memoirs because all of my life was in the notebooks that were in Wheatley's lab, and I don't have the notebooks to tell exactly which day. Then there was a third version of the fridge, in which I didn't work actually on this particular fridge. But I thought it was interesting to show the detail. These are drawings that John Wheatley made in 1967 for the third version of the refrigerator. And this is the picture that is in this article that we wrote. As it turned out, this article appeared in 1968. Wheatley moved to San Diego in 1967. And part of the deal to send him to hire him at San Diego was that they would publish a very long paper on dilution refrigerators. And so Bernd Matthias, who was the editor of this journal that was defunct, decided to resuscitate for one more issue. So issue volume 4 of Physics is our paper, and that's it. But it was part of the package. You know, today people negotiate for $1 million or whatever, startup funds. At the time, publishing this paper was very important. So in addition to whatever funds Wheatley got, he got also this paper published. But John was extremely, extremely detailed. This is his own handwriting of all exactly how each the measurements of every heat exchanger there was on this design. So in 1967, John, at the end of 1966, John decided he was going to move to San Diego. And it, he wanted a much larger space so he could, he was going to build a nuclear demagnetization apparatus to go below 3 millikelvins with helium-3. He was always, his goal was to discover superfluidity in helium-3, so it, or in the, and in the dilute solution, so he needed more space. And they had just expanded the material research lab at Illinois, and he asked for more space in the new lab, and he was told no, because if he got more space, then other vedettes that were there also wanted more space, and they couldn't really give more space to him. So he really got pretty angry and decided that he was going to move to Urbana. And in the meantime, he kept working with the people in Bariloche and finished the first full paper and full thesis done in Bariloche in the always by radio communication. So it was quite interesting. So anyway, in February '67, Richard Johnson and I moved the lab, and his wife moved the house. They bought a house in San Diego, and off we went. At that time, we in San Diego, John stayed in Illinois. Yeah, so I moved the lab and started building a lab. But we didn't have much to do for experiments, so we started working on pomeranchuk cells to see if we could, for the next goal. While John was finishing working on the dilution refrigerator and finishing the thesis of Bill Black and Bill Abel. At the same time, I started looking for a job. I needed another job. And so eventually I left Wheatley in July of 1968 and went to the University of Washington, where I stayed until I retired, or semi-retired, my wife said, 9 years ago. I just thought I'd show that I started working on the pomeranchuk cell, but eventually in a very, you know, the lab was moved in 67. 68, I left. They didn't have any pomeranchuk cell that worked, but by 1969, they had already done this experiment. They was the first one to show the pomeranchuk cooling really worked. And Ian asked me today if the A and B transitions were here, and the answer is yes. If you plot them in a logarithmic scale and expand the scale, you see the A and B transitions that led to the Nobel Prize of Lee Osheroff and Richardson. They also continued working on the dilution refrigerator. So what they did was they added a continuous heat exchanger and did a great study to see how what was the effect of a continuous heat exchanger in suppressing instabilities. And it so went with this and finally got to a dilution refrigerator that got to about 8 millikelvin continuously. This paper now is in 1970. So see, the lab was completely moved. 67, it wasn't operational until 68. By 1970, they had done both the pomeranchuk and this, and the further development of the refrigerator. And so I went looking through my lab, and I found archaeology. I found the remnants of my own first refrigerator, and assembled everything. It's missing the fifth heat exchanger, the mixing chamber, the steel, and the discrete heat exchangers. And here is one of the first, John with other physicists started this company, Superconductivity Helium Electronics, that they made and sold dilution refrigerators plus squid electronics. And here is a model 430 that I bought in 1970 maybe, with my own heat exchanger because the original leaked like a sieve, so I put a smaller heat exchanger there. But this is now look very much like the modern dilution refrigerators, except that it was only this diameter instead of these monsters that exist nowadays everywhere. Some of the older people remember John. He used to love to ride his bike. So he will, when we live in Urbana, he'd ride 10 miles each way every day on his bicycle to go to work. He did trips to Alaska, a trip to Alaska for 6 weeks to get meticulously packed. But he really had a tremendous passion for working the right way, he would call it always. He wanted to, whatever he did, it had to be done right. It couldn't be done quickly, it couldn't be done imperfectly, because maybe he could finish early. He always had this idea that experiments had to be done in a particular way, and then once you were done, you didn't repeat an experiment. You were not trying to repeat and repeat to see if you got the right answer or whatever you thought the right answer was. The first time you try an experiment, he said they're too expensive. He used to say one tube of N grease per publication had to be, you know, because it was expensive enough that was a good gauge to know what we're doing. But you know, but he also was a fun guy. This is a picture him laying in Bariloche on the beach on the summer. It's usually not that warm, but it might have been a very warm day. This is me, actually. This is my oldest daughter inside there. This is Bill Wheatley, Martha Wheatley, and Jane Wheatley, which unfortunately died the following year of leukemia. There was a time in which leukemia was fatal for children. And it, then this is in San Diego, in the property in San Diego. We used to play volleyball there. This is John and Martha, Bill and Ben, and John's mother, and my daughter Alicia, actually. And this is John bought a property on Lopez Island, which is near Seattle, and they used to fly there every summer. And he was laying down, sitting on the, you know, sleeping somewhere there. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Oscar, for this very interesting talk. Yes. Can we have questions?
Can I just comment that I was always amazed at the quantity and quality of the work which John managed to turn out with, obviously an excellent group over so many years.
Yeah.
I mean, it was phenomenal.
Yeah. And he could also change field, you know, because eventually when he went to Los Alamos, he started working on heat engines. He was fascinated by thermodynamics, so he went to the other side. He wanted to build efficient heat engines. And one of the things he built that is on the cover of one of the physics today is a predecessor of today's heat pulse, crowd coolers. How could you really? There's a beautiful picture in the cover of physics today with something full of ice. You know, but it's you get a flame somewhere, you know, with the whole thing to produce the equivalent to the heat pulse. And but it also in Los Alamos he started working on spin polarized hydrogen at the time and looking at these things. And it, he was when he was in Bariloche, he went out. Like I said, he went for 6 months, then for 1 year, then for 18 months. And he had the idea maybe of moving permanently to Bariloche. And he had the idea that of making a company, building a company that manufactured equipment. The labor was cheap in Argentina. But the thing, he wasn't even looking for property to buy. And I know it because I was a translator for him. And my wife was a translator for him, you know. And So we went with a technician looking at property to buy, But the problem was that there was not enough electricity for any major industry in Bariloche. When we ran the adiabatic demagnetization cryostat, we had to do it at midnight because if not, we couldn't turn on the magnet. And there was not enough water even in the lab in Bariloche. So the students, De La Cruz and I, built a trench all the way 100 yards to a canal that diverted water from one lake to the other lake. And we would go at night while we were running the magnet and had to go and unplug the filters for all the material they collected at the entrance of the filter of the pump or the poor magnet would die, you know. And it was too hard. So he gave up. But he didn't give up completely because after the dilution refrigerator appeared, he had this idea always of having a company that made very high-tech equipment. And he and Jim Zimmerman, who had worked on the RF squid and the other squid type of squids, built SHE with, and only Lonasma. They were all partners on this, plus investors that were in the company. The company eventually failed for lack of capital. They couldn't really raise enough capital to compete with Oxford Instruments or any other large company, and he didn't want to sell it. So the business guy said, well, now that your company is fine, sell it. You know, it's the only way you're going to succeed. But John he wanted the thing to be his company. And they always say that this is a big mistake by scientists turn entrepreneurs to believe that the company is their company. Once you get in the business world, it's a business. It's not your company anymore. The lab, we are privileged to be in the lab and do whatever we want to do. But that's my take on it.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes.